So let's switch gears for 1 second. So there's all this, you know, Jay McGonigal talks about stuff, you know, health-related games a lot. There's all this, like, interesting little bits of evidence that certain kinds of games can positively influence health outcomes, that they can help people feel better about themselves, that they can help people lose weight, that they can help people, de-stress, as an example. How come games are not part of the standard medical process yet, despite there being 30 years of some of this data, number one? And number two, how long will it be until insurance companies cover games as a form of treatment? Like, I can get a until I can get a script for Halo and pay my copay.
I don't think anybody can answer that second question. why haven't we done it so far? I mean, we're a 160-year-old insurance company in a regulated environment. We don't have people like Gabe sitting inside our user experience teams, right? So part of it's just, you know, we grew up in an environment where this DNA doesn't exist. But as we move into the post-healthcare reform world and we're becoming more consumer-centric and not just focused on the B2B to B2C relationships that we have, we know that we have to change the type of relationship that we have with the consumer. And therefore, we've got a lot of folks that are now starting to take these things into consideration, and hence the things that we're experimenting with.
And you know, second piece of that, you know, around, you know, when are we going to start to pay for games? It's I think part of it is people will call it a game. It's instead of it saying it's an exercise program, you start looking at where, you know, Microsoft is going with the Kinect and tools, or not tools, but the games out there like Dance Central. They could be almost considered a form of exercise. And, you know, until reform, until, you know, the regulations and stuff catch up to where this is and what these things are, I think that's when, you know, we might see a script for a game out there, if you want to.
So tell me this, Ron. Andres, tell me this. So let's say we took Dance Dance Revolution and repackaged it and said, weight loss fun, happy, shiny weight loss game. Would it still be as effective if it came from your doctor?
Well, it depends. I mean, you need to build an ecosystem. And I just want to follow up on your question, but also on what they said. Do insurance companies need to be on the hook for that? I think that we need to build in health games, right, that are intrinsically motivated, that are not for the money part of it, because they're co-paid. I mean, no one pays people to play Zynga games. The opposite is true, right?
Right.
The people pay to play them, right? So can we build games that are good enough and employ enough components of what motivates us as human beings, what motivates our physicians or human beings to participate in that, and not ask them to be paid by the insurance companies, and people will do it because it's fun. And I think that the word fun came only once in this entire panel, and I think we should bring it again, because I think that what we can use with game is the fun element, right, to start measuring what we're doing, to start enjoying what we're doing in health, and then make it sustainable, right? So the question is, maybe the insurance companies can help by supporting these companies or the industry that actually creates these games, whether it's the big players or the small players that are building games or platforms for games, that can help them build these things, because at the end of the day, people pay them for what they are, and then the insurance companies need to pay less.
I think that's a great rallying cry.